the breathing rate increases. We know that when the breathing rate increases, when the body demands more oxygen, the breathing rate increases. So during any activity, the breathing rate increases. Here the body is not active, the body is relaxing, but the mind is active. And because of that, the breathing rate and rhythm gets affected. And this is the connection between breath and the mind, which is utilized by yoga. So in yoga and pranayama in particular, this relationship between breath and mind is very, very critical. And that's why we can, because it's not possible to control the mind directly. It's not possible to control the mind directly. I always quote Dr. Nagaratna Didi from S. Vyasa. She always quotes that yoga is nothing but management of monkeying of mind. Monkeying of mind. My mind works like a monkey. So mind cannot be controlled directly. We cannot sit just with eyes closed and say that now I am sitting with my eyes closed and now I am going to reduce the number of thoughts in my mind. That is never going to happen. In fact, when I say that I want to reduce the number of thoughts, immediately the thoughts will increase. And this is how, so this is how the mind can be controlled, by controlling the breath. If we are able to control the breath, if we are able to reduce the rate of the breathing, the thought process of the mind will reduce, the process of mind will reduce. And this is how the quietening of the mind can be done, by controlling the breath. This is the relationship between. So in order to know this, understand this relationship of pranayama, chalevate charanjitam, it is necessary to understand the physiology and anatomy of the breathing apparatus. And that's why it is important for us to learn all the things which we have been discussing for the past 1.5 hours. So this is a mind-body relationship. So now the modern medical science also says it is a mind-body medicine, not only mind medicine or body medicine. Mind and body are linked together, and the bridge between the mind and body is the breath. So that's why this has been recognized by our ancient science of yoga thousands of years back, which is recognized by modern science in the past few years only. So change of depth and speed of the breath will be caused because of fear, panic, and so many things, even though the body is at rest. So the mind, so we'll just enumerate the effect of different yoga sadhana on the respiratory system. Yama Niyama is the first two angas of Ashtanga Yoga. As we know that when we are doing Yama Niyama, when we are adhering to Yama Niyama, that will lead to calm state of mind. Ahimsa Satya Asteya Aparigraha, because whenever we steal something, the mind is never at rest. Even though outwardly a thief, we will perceive that thief is calm and quiet, but it's not the so. It's not the case. Always his mind is agitated because of his doing reverse of Yama Niyama. If you observe Yama Niyama, the mind will automatically become calm, and a calm mind will lead to normal rhythm and speed of the respiration. And that's why observing Yama Niyama are the first angas mentioned by Patanjali. Unless we observe Yama Niyama, we will not be able to proceed on the path of yoga. And Yama Niyama will lead to calmness of mind. In Sukshma Vyayam, we know that the circulation of the whole body is enhanced. The muscle, different muscle groups are utilized in Sukshma Vyayam. So muscle tone is enhanced. So there is a better blood supply to the cells of the body, and there is better internal respiration. And because of the action on the blood circulation and the muscles, the respiratory muscles also are toned up, and they also can function properly. Because we know that, we have discussed that the secondary respiratory muscles, accessory muscles, they are not utilized in the usual breathing. But whenever there is emergency, we have to run away from something. The emergency that, for example, we are walking on the road and a vehicle is coming towards us, we have to run away. If our muscles are strong, especially accessory muscles, we can run away properly. Even though we are in the habit of running, if the muscles are not toned up, we will not be able to enhance the rate of respiration, which is required. So these are interconnections between the muscular system and the respiratory system. So Sukshmayam are very effective for respiratory system as well. In the asana, Sthira Sukhamasanam, Prayatna Shaithilya, Anansa Samapatti, as specified by Patanjali, the final posture, the breathing is supposed to be slow. Because of Prayatna Shaithilya, the breathing should not get enhanced. If you are doing, the breathing is activated in asana, then that is not asana, right? if the breathing rate goes up in the final posture of the asana, that cannot be called as asana. That is some kind of exercise. So the breathing rate should drop down actually in the final posture because of prayatna shaithilya. Of course, there are some asanas which will expand the thoracic cage in different directions, like Bhujangasana, Ustrasana, Matsyasana, Marjasana. So they are working on the different muscle groups of the thoracic cage. So all the muscles get toned up because of those asanas, because they are expanding the thoracic cage, and that's how the breathing becomes enhanced or breathing becomes better because of the practice of asana. And when we have Sakshi Bhava towards breath, as we know, when we have breath awareness, Sakshi Bhava, automatically the breathing becomes slow. Automatically the breathing becomes slow. So this is the effect of asana on the respiration. The meditative asanas, because we began the class with the om chanting, and before that we said that we should keep our back erect. So in meditative asanas, the back is erect but relaxed, so that all the muscles which are controlling the posture are in optimum state of contraction. They are not extra contracted. When we bend in the front or bend in the back, bend in the side, the different muscle groups will come into the picture, the action will come into the picture. And here in the meditative asanas, since the back is straight, all those muscles which are controlling the posture are in the optimum contraction state. So minimum they are working to the minimum level only, not maximum level. So there is no resistance to all the respiratory muscles in the meditative asana, and that's why the thoracic cage is free to expand in all directions. We understand that, and that's why meditative asanas are critical for the practice of pranayama, because the meditative asanas will maintain the healthy breathing pattern. And once that is done, then only we can control the breath, which we are supposed to do in pranayama practice. So the meditative asanas are conducive to the practice of pranayama. Of course, there are changes in the blood flow, like in Vajrasana, the blood flow is more towards the abdomen and it is taken slightly away from the extremities. So there is one other aspect of meditative asanas, but basically because of the Samamkaya Shirogriha I described in Bhagavad Gita. So the erect posture is conducive to the practice of pranayama because the breathing becomes easy because of that. Now Kapalabhati is a peculiar breathing practice. We have seen that the inhalation is the active process and exhalation is passive process as far as usual breath is concerned. In Kapalabhati, we do it in reverse case. So we must understand Shatkriyas. In Shatkriyas, most of the Shatkriyas, we are doing the reverse function of the body in a conscious way. So consciously, we control the different functions of the body, which happen otherwise in an automatic manner. Like breathing happens automatically, the inhalation is active, exhalation is passive. In Kapalabhati, we reverse that. The exhalation becomes active, inhalation becomes passive. So we are altering the breathing pattern, and that's how, through altering, this is one of the ways of controlling the particular activity. So we can alter that and control the activity. So it is a reverse breathing pattern followed in Kapalabhati. So it has got effect on all the muscles of the respiration and the respiratory center as well. Now Kapalabhati, what happens that the number of breaths per minute in Kapalabhati are much more than the normal usual breathing. So Kapalabhati, ideally it is supposed to be, according to many yoga gurus, the ideal Kapalabhati is 120 times per minute, and normal breathing rate is 14 to 16 per minute. There's so much activity going on of the breath in Kapalabhati. So what happens that the extra air from the lungs is thrown out, so that even the respiratory reservoir also is thrown out a bit, not completely, at least in parts, so that more air can get exchanged. Because since the more air gets thrown out, the more air can enter the lungs, and there is a scope of exchange of air in increased volume. Now, after practicing Kapalabhati, say 50-60 times, we experience that there is a cessation of breath for some time. It's called as apnea, automatic apnea, or Sahaja Kumbhak in yogic stage. So we need to understand why this happens. As we have seen, that exhalation is enhanced in Kapalabhati as compared with usual breath. So all the extra carbon dioxide is getting washed out of the system. So after Kapalabhati, the amount of oxygen in the blood reduces. And we have already discussed that the medulla oblongata is much more sensitive to the concentration of carbon dioxide rather than the oxygen. Now here after, it will not happen after 10-15 minutes of Kapalbhati. We must understand that. So there is a particular volume which needs to wash out. So that takes about 50 or 60 strokes of Kapalbhati. The carbon dioxide gets washed out and the chemoreceptors perceive that there is less carbon dioxide in the blood. So there is no need of continuing breathing. So breathing will stop automatically. At the same time, the tissue respiration is going on. The cells are not going to stop. The cells are breathing all the time. So the cells are processing the oxygen. They are throwing out the carbon dioxide in the blood. Again, the carbon dioxide starts rising in the blood. So the medulla gets activated. As if we experience that, I don't know whether everybody has experienced that. So after Kapalbhati, 50, 60, 70 rounds, the breath will stop for some times, and then a deep breath will be taken in. Because of that action of medulla oblongata, since the carbon dioxide again starts rising, a deep breath will come inside. And because of that deep breath, more oxygen will be taken inside the blood. And because of the oxygen, again the medulla will be depressed slightly, so that the rate of the breathing will come down. The Kapalbhati is a three-step process actually. One is the active process of throwing out the air. Second is the automatic apnea stage. And the third is the reduction in the rate of breathing after Kapalbhati. And that's how it's always suggested that we should always do Kapalbhati before doing pranayama, because the breathing rate comes down and is conducive to the practice of pranayama. And that's how this Kapalbhati, even though it is a kriya, is an important practice as a precondition for pranayama. The neti, jananeti and sutraneti, they cleanse the nasal cavity physically. They reduce the oversensitivity of the mucous membrane, as we have already discussed the sensitivity of the mucous membrane inside the nasal cavity. And because of the cleaning of nasal cavity, the blockages are removed, so the breathing becomes easy. Then Dhauti practices we have already discussed, they remove excess secretions from the respiratory tract. The Shankha Prakshalan and Basti practices, even though they have got focus of effect on the digestive system, basically because they clean out the digestive system, they reduce the pressure on the diaphragm. All of us must have experienced sometime when we eat in excess or when there is constipation, the breathing becomes difficult. Why? Because there is a pressure of the digestive organs on the diaphragm. Because of this Basti and Shankha Prakshalan, the pressure on the diaphragm is reduced. So you must have observed that after doing Shankha Prakshalan practice, the breathing becomes easy. And this is how we try to bring control over the autonomic nervous system. The yogic breathing, again, we control, we bring conscious control or different muscle groups. So specific muscle groups are used in specific yogic breathing. In case of abdominal breathing, we use only the diaphragm in much more enhanced way. Thoracic breathing, the intercostal muscles are used in enhanced way. That doesn't mean that in abdominal breathing there is no use of intercostal muscles, or there is no use of diaphragm in thoracic muscles. Only focus is different. The focus is different. And the shoulder breathing is a peculiar practice where we bring the accessory muscles in the picture. Otherwise, they are not in the picture. That's why yogic breathing is very important yoga sadhana for improving our breathing apparatus. And that's why yogic breathing is a must in every sadhaka's sadhana, every time before the practice of pranayama. In the long run, that will tune up all the muscles of the respiration in a better way. And there's a practice of chanting akar ukar makar at some institutes along with yogic breathing. So that will, because of the vibrations, that will tone up all the muscles of the respiration in yogic breathing. Pranayama, of course, puraka is the highest expansion of the lungs because it enhances intake of air, because the puraka means the controlled extended inhalation is called as puraka. So in the puraka, the inhalation is controlled and extended, and because of that, there is the maximum expansion of the lungs. So that improves the lung elasticity. In the rechaka, it's a prolonged exhalation with control of the brain, and that improves the recoil of the lungs. So recoil is a technical term which is used for the lungs. Whenever anything is elastic in nature, or in physics is a principle in the physics also. Anything is elastic, the expansion and recoil. So they come like a spring. You stretch the spring, it when the force is removed, it comes back to normal. That's called as recoil. So that recoil is improved because of Raichaka practice. Kumbhaka, especially Antar Kumbhaka, will give more time for diffusion of gases inside the alveoli and blood vessels. Antar Kumbhaka. Bahir Kumbhaka, as we know that because of Bahir Kumbhaka, already exhalation is complete. And while exhaling, the diaphragm is relaxed. So in Bahir Kumbhaka, the diaphragm, all the intercostal muscles are relaxed for longer time. So they get the proper rest. Otherwise, they don't get that much rest. So rest is given in Bahir Kumbhaka. So the breathing rate may become 1-3 in pranayama. Sometimes it can become 1 per minute also, like Anulom Vilom and other pranayamas. Then in Bhastrika, there is a conscious increase in breathing rate, and that leads to toning up of all the muscles of respiration. So Bhastrika leads to improvement in the respiratory capacity. And in Kumbhaka in particular, the nervous system gets tuned to the increased concentration of carbon dioxide in the blood. As we know that the neurons inside the brain are very sensitive to oxygen. So if the neurons don't receive oxygen supply for 3-4 minutes, they will die. They will die forever. But as in the case of yogis, anecdotally, you must have heard that yogis are able to live without breathing, or there are some experiments being done at Kavellam and other institutes where the yogis are kept in airtight chamber and then they observe what is happening. So even though air is not coming inside a chamber, yogis can still live because of that Kumbhaka, enhanced Kumbhaka practice, the nervous systems, gets tuned to increase carbon dioxide in the blood. So because in Kumbhaka, there is less oxygen and more carbon dioxide, many centers of the brain will shut down. They will shut down. The cells will not die. They will shut down. Only the autonomic part will continue to function. And as we breathe in again, those will be activated. So that will be happen. That can be done only through a prolonged yoga sadhana. Of course, Kumbhaka should not be increased too much in the beginning, but that will be harmful. But yogis are tuned to doing that Kumbhaka. That's why in Hatha Yoga, the pranayama is called as Kumbhaka. Kumbhaka is so important. Anulom Vilom pranayama will lead to balance of autonomic system, Ida Pingala Nadis, sympathetic and parasympathetic. It is supposed that the right nostril, the sympathetic gets activated, left nostril, parasympathetic gets activated, and the balance is caused because of Anulom Vilom pranayama, because there is a balance between left and right nostril while doing Anulom Vilom pranayama. The Surya Bhedan pranayama leads to increased energy because there is more inhalation through right nostril. Of course, that has been some experiments have been done. But logically, as per modern scientific concept, there is no difference between right and left nostril. But this research is on everywhere. Shitali and Sitkari are peculiar pranayams where the breathing is done through the mouth. Especially inhalation is done through the mouth. So Shitali and Sitkari pranayams help in improving the breathing capacity. At the same time, due care has to be observed because there is no filtration of the air. There is no warming up of the air as happens in the nasal cavity. Directly, the cool air or impure air also is likely to reach the lungs. So you have to observe extra care during Shitali Sitkari pranayama. In the polluted atmosphere, we should avoid doing Shitali Sitkari pranayama. In the Brahmari pranayama, the exhalation is prolonged quite a bit because of that sound of Brahmari. And because of that, the lung is gets completely deflated. And once it gets deflated, it can expand in a better way also. So, and again in Brahmari, there is a prolonged laryngeal contraction that has got the effect on the larynx and voice also, the sound also. That's why, and it leads to, you know, inner peace of mind. That's called as Chidanandakari. And in Ujjayi pranayama in particular, the apical lungs are utilized because the muscles of the neck are utilized in Ujjayi pranayama. So the unutilized part of the lungs are utilized in Ujjayi pranayama, the apical part. These are the benefits of individual pranayama on the respiratory system. The alveoli are stretched more, and so the especially you will observe that even though in Puraka there will be 1,000 to 1,500 ml air intake inside the body per breath, and in normal breathing it is 500, but there will be only one to three breaths per minute in a proper person who is doing pranayama. Initially, of course, if a new sadhaka, the breathing rate will not come down. It is not supposed to come down so much, but in a sadhaka who is doing yoga sadhana for a long time, it may come down to 1 or 2 also. So overall air intake is reduced in pranayama. But in pranayama, the requirement of oxygen also gets reduced because you are sitting in dhyanatmaka asana, your mind is at rest. So the body does not require more oxygen. And that's why with less oxygen also, body can manage. And in the purak, extra air comes inside the lungs. In Tribandha Yukta Pranayam, Tribandha and Kumbhak Yukta Pranayam, so there is a pressure on the breathing muscle, especially the diaphragm gets pressure because of the Mula Bandha and Uddiyan Bandha. And Jalandha Bandha, there is a pressure on the baroreceptors, they get toned up properly. So Kumbhaka plus Bandha gives rise to tremendous pressure on the breathing apparatus. And because of that, the muscles get toned up properly. So in short, the control of the respiration leads to, it is a key to control the mind-body complex or the mind complex, and it modulates the emotional patterns. As we have seen that the breathing and emotions are linked to each other, so that leads to modulation of the emotional patterns, and that is a key of the pranayam sadhana in yoga. And the respiratory rhythm is maintained because of the yoga sadhana, and it leads to control over autonomic nervous system. It leads to vagal tone also. Vagal tone is a topic by itself to be discussed, which has been researched quite extensively in the last few years. So vagal tone is responsible for the functioning of all the organs of the abdomen. If the vagal tone is maintained properly, then all the organs will function properly. And through pranayama, it is supposed that when we have control of respiration, through the respiratory rhythm, we can control the vagal tone also. And once that happens, then the function of all the organs will improve. And that's why pranayama is supposed to be a higher level of sadhana, or it has been called as pranayama param tapam. So it is a higher level of sadhana. And that's how the pranayama practice or pranayama sadhana will lead to the improvement of function of the whole body. Just the names of some diseases or disorders which are to be discussed, because as a yoga therapist, we have to have knowledge of disorders also. And in order to have knowledge of disorders, we need to have knowledge of the physiology and anatomy of that particular system. So these are disorders, at least not like medical personnel, but as a yoga therapist, you need to know the basics of the disorders. What is exactly the problem in the particular disorder? Why a particular disorder is different than the other disorder? So at least this much yoga therapist needs to know. So all these diseases have to be discussed as a yoga therapist. So as a yoga therapist, we are not going to become medical personnel, but being a yoga therapist, we have to have at least the basic minimum knowledge of the disease process and the disorders of the body. And that's why try to revise all the systems, anatomy and physiology of all the systems. If you understand the functional systems, you will be able to understand the disorders and disease in a better way. And that's why I just enumerated these disorders. I thank you for your patient attendance. It has been quite a long session. And I've tried a bit fast also, I've gone to complete the topic. But I hope that you revise it. And